In the last video, you saw how the SkipGrad model allows you to construct a supervised learning task where you map from context to target words and how that allows you to learn a useful word embedding. But the downside of that was the softmax objective was slow to compute. In this video, you see a modified learning problem called negative sampling that allows you to do something similar to the SkipGrad model you saw just now, but with a much more efficient learning algorithm. Let's see how you could do that. Most of the ideas presented in this video are due to Thomas Mikhailov, Aya Suskever, Kai Chen, Greg Corrado, and Jeff Dean. So what we're going to do in this algorithm is create a new supervised learning problem. And the problem is, given a pair of words like orange and juice, we're going to predict, is this a context target pair? So in this example, orange juice was a positive example. And how about orange and king? Well, that's a negative example. So I'm going to write 0 for the target. So what we're going to do is we're actually going to sample a context and a target word. So in this case, we had orange and juice, and we'll put associate that with a label of 1. So let me just put word in the middle. And then having generated a positive example, so the positive example is generated exactly how we generated it in the previous videos. Sample a context word, look around a window of say plus minus 10 words and pick a target word. So that's how you generate the first row of this table with orange juice 1. And then to generate the negative example, it's going to take the same context word and then just pick a word at random from the dictionary. So in this case, I chose the word king at random and we'll label that as 0. And then let's take orange and let's pick another random word from the dictionary. Under the assumption that if we pick a random word, it probably won't be associated with the word orange. So with orange book, 0. And let's pick a few others. Orange, maybe just by chance, we'll pick the 0 and then orange. And maybe just by chance, we'll pick the word of and we'll put a 0 there. And notice that of is labeled as 0, even though the word of actually appears next to orange as well. So to summarize, the way we generated this data set is we'll pick a context word and then pick a target word. And that is the first row of this table. That gives us a positive example. So context, target, and then give that a label of 1. And then what we'll do is, for some number of times, say k times, we're going to take the same context word and then pick random words from the dictionary, king, book, the, of, whatever comes out at random from the dictionary, and label all those 0. And those will be our negative examples. And it's okay if just by chance one of those words we picked at random from the dictionary happens to appear in a window, in a plus minus 10 word window, say, next to the context word orange. Then we're going to create a supervised learning problem where the learning algorithm inputs x, inputs this pair of words, and then has to predict the target label, or to predict the output y. So the problem is really, given a pair of words like orange and juice, do you think they appear together? Do you think I got these two words by sampling two words close to each other? Or do you think I got them as one word from the text and one word chosen at random from the dictionary? It's really to try to distinguish between these two types of distributions from which you might sample a pair of words. So this is how you generate the training set. How do you choose K? Mikhailov et al. Recommend that maybe K is 5 to 20 for smaller data sets. And if you have a very large data set, then choose K to be smaller. So K equals 2 to 5 for larger data sets and larger values of K for smaller data sets. Okay. And in this example, I've just used K equals 4. Next, let's describe the supervised learning model for learning a mapping from X to Y. So here was the softmax model you saw from the previous video. And here is the training set we got from the previous slide, where, again, this is going to be the new input X, and this is going to be the value of Y you're trying to predict. So to define the model, I'm going to use this to denote this with C for the context word, this to denote the possible target word, T, and this I'll use Y to denote 0, 1. You know, is this a context target pair? So what we're going to do is define a logistic regression model. We say that the chance that Y is equal to 1, given the input C, T pair, we're going to model this as basically a logistic regression model, but the specific formula we use is sigmoid applied to theta transpose, theta t transpose E C. So the parameters are similar as before. You have one parameter vector theta for each possible target word and a separate parameter vector, really the embedding vector, for each possible context word. And we're going to use this formula to estimate the probability that y is equal to 1. So if you have k examples here, then you can think of this as having a k to 1 ratio of negative to positive examples. So for every positive examples, you will have k negative examples with which to train this logistic regression-like model. And so to draw this as a neural network, if the input word is orange, which is word 6257, then what you do is you input the one hot vector, pass it through E, do that multiplication to get the embedding vector, 6257, and then what you have is really 10,000 possible logistic regression classification problems, where one of these will be the classifier corresponding to, well, is the target word juice or not? And then there'll be other words. For example, there might be one somewhere down here which is predicting is the word king or not, and so on, for these are possible words in your vocabulary. So think of this as having 10,000 binary logistic regression classifiers, but instead of training all 10,000 of them on every iteration, we're only going to train 5 of them. We're going to train the one corresponding to the actual target word we got, and then train 4 randomly chosen negative examples. And this is for the case where k is equal to 4. So instead of having one giant 10,000 way softmax, which is very expensive to compute, we've instead turned it into 10,000 binary classification problems, each of which is quite cheap to compute. And on every iteration, we're only going to train 5 of them, or more generally, k plus 1 of them, with k negative examples and 1 positive examples. And this is why the computational cost of this algorithm is much lower, because you're updating k plus 1 logistic units, k plus 1 binary classification problems, which is relatively cheap to do on every iteration, rather than updating a 10,000 way softmax classifier. So you get to play with this algorithm in the programming exercise for this week as well. So this technique is called negative sampling, because what you're doing is you had a positive example, the orange and then juice, and then you would go out and deliberately generate a bunch of negative examples, kind of negative samplings, hence the name negative sampling, which wish to train 4 more of these binary classifiers. And on every iteration, you choose 4 different random negative words with which to train your algorithm on. Now, before wrapping up, one more important detail of this algorithm is how do you choose the negative examples? So after having chosen the context word orange, how do you sample these words to generate the negative examples? So one thing you could do is sample the words in the middle, the candidate target word. One thing you could do is sample it according to the empirical frequency of words in your corpus. So just sample it according to, you know, how often different words appears. But the problem of that is that you end up with a very high representation of words like the, of, and so on. One other extreme would be to say you use, one over the vocab size, sample the negative examples uniformly at random, but that's also very non-representative of the distribution of English words. So the authors, Mikhailov et al., reported that empirically what they found to work best was to take this heuristic value, which is a little bit in between the two extremes of sampling from the empirical frequencies, from meaning from whatever is the observed distribution in English text to the uniform distribution. And what they did was they sampled proportional to the frequency of a word to the power of 3/4. So if f of wi is the observed frequency of a particular word in the English language or in your training set corpus, then by taking it to the power of 3/4, this is somewhere in between the extreme of taking uniform distribution and the other extreme of just taking whatever was the observed distribution in your training set. And so I'm not sure this is very theoretically justified, but multiple researchers are now using this heuristic and it seems to work decently well. So to summarize, you've seen how you can learn word vectors of a SOCmaths classifier, but that's very computationally expensive. And in this video, you saw how by changing that to a bunch of binary classification problems, you can very efficiently learn word vectors. And if you run this algorithm, you will be able to learn pretty good word vectors. Now, of course, as is the case in other areas of deep learning as well, there are open source implementations, and there are also pre-trained word vectors that others have trained and released online under permissive licenses. And so if you want to get going quickly on a NLP problem, it'd be reasonable to download someone else's word vectors and use that as a starting point. So that's it for the SkipGram model. In the next video, I want to share with you yet another version of a word embedding learning algorithm that is maybe even simpler than what you've seen so far. So in the next video, let's learn about the glove algorithm.